Right, that's amazing. what I'm going to do is, so my talk has like two parts. So basically, like after some time, if you think you need a little break while everybody has questions and stuff, we can think about that because of this kind of longer talk. So first of all, thank you very much for this opportunity. We all are pretty happy to be here and to present not just the instrumentation and how to work with microplastics on our instrumentation, but also to share some of our experiences with polymers in general, because FTIR has been around for a very, very long time. And polymers is one of the biggest thing that FTIR has helped analyze, has helped QC, QA, all the stuff around. But now this, when it comes to microplastics, it's a totally different challenge, but it still is polymer. So we are basically here to help out with what we have learned so far and how we can help you with those kind of information that we have learned. So just like Steve mentioned, I have my presentations in a USB, which I will provide to all of you, as well as you can use those USBs tomorrow, especially for the folks who are going to be in the lab, because you may find some really interesting materials in the samples that we extracted last night. And you can save your pictures, you can save some .csv files, so when you go back, you still have something to play around with. You can play with the software online and everything like that, so you have a little thing to take back home to, okay, so let's move forward. So like I said, FTIR spectroscopy has been around for a very long time. So if you ask me why, and for the folks who may have used it before, it's like the reason is almost no sample prep, and it's one of the fastest ways to analyze. So if you go to a production facility which is doing polymers, if you go to a raw materials place where it is manufacturing something, they all have an FTIR because they want to see whether the raw material is pure, whether the material has gone through any changes, degradation, and so forth. And if you think about what can be analyzed with IR, organics, inorganics, films, coatings, papers, and anything under the sun, basically. But there are things that cannot be looked at with IR too. So that's the part that we have to differentiate today. What we can look at, how well we can look at, and then the question is, so usually when we do these type of analysis for a general, in general, it is like, okay, is it quantitative or is it qualitative? What kind of analysis do you want to do, right? And all the different areas that it works on and folks use FTIRs for is all the way from R&D to QA/QC, failure analysis, everything that you can think of. So Una went over the whole electromagnetic spectrum and how things work very, very in detail. So I will just summarize some of the things around here. So you have a broad electromagnetic spectrum up here, of which the IR is going to be just, when we say mid-IR, it's a very small fraction that you're going to work with. The infrared by itself is a very large area. But infrared for us, when we talk about the mid-infrared, is mainly for identity purposes. And we will talk about and learn how to identify materials using mid-infrared. That's our goal. But there is also near infrared, which is also a very, very powerful technology for doing complex quantitations, for doing complex material identification, and mostly if you are interested in blending and other sorts of things. Then there is the far infrared by itself. The far infrared is one of the most upcoming fields of infrared. We will talk about a little bit in detail about the upcoming areas and trends and so forth as well. But you will realize over the next 2 days, actually the next 5 days, is that the mid-infrared is what most of you will focus on. And the reason the mid-infrared is what you will mostly focus on is most of the organics will have peaks right in the mid-infrared region. And the inorganics is what you will have more peaks in the far infrared region. So we looked at the same before. When we look at the spectrum, what are you looking at? You have an energy on the x-axis and you have a response on the y-axis. So this you can show it as an absorption, transmittance, you can show it in reflectance. There's a lot of different ways to show this. A lot of different ways you will see in literature. If you take some very old papers on polymers, you won't see this wave number depiction, but what you're going to see is micron depictions. There is still a lot of academia folks who still may use the micron depiction. Everything is fine. You have wave numbers, which is one by centimeter, so you can just always go back and forth. But the general norm now is to use mid-infrared in wave numbers. And that's just for the ease of the spread that you can see for the spectrum. That's why we do that. But when it comes to mid-infrared, what you're going to see is there's different kinds of representation. And each of this can be a slightly different measurement parameter, a measurement technique in its own way. And we have to learn where to use what and more efficiently. So, like I said, almost everything can be analyzed with infrared, but you have to learn what are the materials that will show a really good infrared spectrum and what are the materials that will not show and what really governs this, right? So, if you think about IR activity selection rule, the first one, so the frequency of the light must be identical to the frequency of vibration. That's definitely important, that wherever you see the peak, that's because the material or the bond is absorbing right there. But this one is going to be the key also when you think about, oh, is this IR active material or not? And that is that the dipole of the molecule must change when you hit it with the light. Because the absorption has to happen, this dipole might change for that. The last one is basically going to be more for folks who are doing a lot of surface chemistries and surface analysis. So we will not talk about it right now, but then we go to lab and we will talk more in details about how that affects our measurements as well. So what really happens at the atomic level when you hit a sample with light or with mid-infrared light? So there's the representation for a light mass and for heavy mass. So remember I said for most of your work you are going to use mid-infrared because most of your material will have carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen in different forms, all very light atom materials, right? But it is also there that a lot of folks will work with calcium, magnesium, and things like that that are bound to these heavier atoms. So when you have heavier atoms, what happens is your frequency is more towards the lower end. That is the far infrared frequency. So that's why I was mentioning the far infrared. So a lot and lot of inorganic folks, we call inorganic folks as folks who really work a lot on the inorganic materials. They are now moving into characterizing these things with IR as well. There is an advantage to that. But mostly, almost 90% of the academia or the industry works on the mid-infrared region. So when you hit something with, like, let me just go back once more, what happens is it starts to vibrate. And it is this vibration that you are measuring, right? You can have dipoles that will be very, very strong. So we have learned in our high school as well as in our grad school, basically that if you have a very, there are more atoms that can have very strong dipoles, very weak dipoles, there can be ionic bonds and so many different types. So if you have a very strong dipole, what's going to happen is your peaks are going to have really strong absorbances. Peaks are going to be really, really strong. So earlier there was a question, I think from back, that there is a reason, like when you see sometimes the IR will work better, sometimes Raman will work better. There are materials that, in general term, will be weak IR absorbers. Those sometimes may be really good Raman scatterers. So that's where you may start to see that both techniques together works really complementary. Then there is diatomic molecules, like nitrogen gas, oxygen gas. You will never see them because there is no dipole and nothing really happens with it. That's why we can use them as purge gases. So a lot of times we do recommend that that the instrument be purged and we use a purge bench because then you can avoid carbon dioxide, you can avoid moisture because think about a carbon dioxide and moisture molecule. You know, had shown that nice vibration of water, right? So you have a nice V-shaped molecule nicely sitting and vibrating, and OH is actually a very, very, very strong bond for IR. So the problem is, yeah, it's great if you have a tiny bit of moisture, and if you're interested in moisture analysis, which the entire pharma industry does, what they do is they use infrared because they want to study how much moisture is in there because it's a very strong absorber, right? So you can see it very easily to a very, very low extent. But it can be a problem too. So that's why we can use nitrogen or dry air technically to purge the instrument if required. Okay, so the next simple but principle that we have to keep in mind is when there is two atoms and they're vibrating, we learned that this frequency of vibration is going to be inversely proportional to the mass of the atom. So the lower the mass, higher the wave numbers you're going to see. Heavier the atoms, the lower you're going to see. So that, knowing that, once we run a sample, what happens? We get a spectrum, very nice simple spectrum, right? So here we have a simple spectrum of polycarbonate. But how do we know this is polycarbonate? Because all we do, or all we need to do, is run it against a standard library. So this is where it is important, and this afternoon we will address this in very much detail, is the libraries by itself. And I know Una is going to work, be talking on the same thing for Raman as well. For standard materials, this is great. So if you know you have polycarbonate, you can easily match it up to, I mean, if you have it in the library, it will easily match up. But in your case, a lot of materials will not be as simple as what you're looking. You know yourself. The reason is it may be slightly degraded. It may have weathered. It may have oxidized. You may not have that variation yet in the database. So what you may get is maybe not like a 97 match or so. At that time is what you want to start thinking. Oh, okay, this is basically polycarbonate, but it has come through a lot of processes, or it has gone through a lot in the nature. So that's what we will have to talk this afternoon, as well as while we do the samples in the lab. But as simple as that is, you have your spectrum, you just compare it, and you know what the material is. So it's very straightforward. So let's look a little bit inside the instrument, or how an FTIR instrument works. So FTIR instruments have been around almost for more than, I would say, 60 years now, or IR instruments has been around for 60 years now. I think some of the first ones were in the year 1940s when an IR instrument was there. But it's almost like 35 to 40 years ago is when it became an FTIR. Earlier it was a dispersive IR. Some of you may have seen in some universities, like the old IRs will be half the size of this bench because these are dispersive instruments. So you have these big monochromators sitting and rotating, and it takes almost an hour to do one spectrum and so forth. But what really revolutionized the IR technology to go into the labs and go into all these like really small instruments, small devices, is two things. One is the interferometer by itself, and then the second thing is FT and then faster computers. So what goes on is you have an IR source and you have two mirrors. So the combination of these two is what we call the interferometer, and the type that we use inside our instruments is called the Michelson's interferometer, which is very standard in FTIR, which is composed of a moving mirror and a fixed mirror and a beam splitter right there. So this beam splitter, for most of the mid-infrared work, you will always have a KBR or potassium bromide beam splitter. So what really happens here is the light hits the beam splitter, it goes into two different mirrors. The moving mirror is constantly moving, the fixed mirror, it's going to be at one position, so it just reflects back right down. So let's look a little bit deeper and how it will work, and then it, both these will combine back up, and then it hits the detector, right? So what's really going on? So when it hits the moving mirror, as well as the fixed mirror, there's a slight, what it does is there are two interference, basically you're just, they are going to form constructive and destructive interference patterns. So that's what is represented basically as the detector signal here, flat lines, and you can get really nice bursts out there. So thinking about four frequencies, this is like just thinking about four frequencies, one, two, three, four different frequencies, right? So it can be as simple as this. 10 frequencies can look as complicated as this. But what we work with or what we talk about when we say mid-infrared is an entire region, starting from 400 down to almost like 4,000 or 7,400 region. So this is a very broad region, you know, a broad source, right? And what you end up doing is, you see is this really nice center burst, and you will have the rest of it as flat region. That is what your interferogram is. So till the collection of interferogram is all that the instrument does. The rest of it is all the magic that the computer does. So this is what the instrument will do. We'll collect a background, we'll collect a sample, and from there on, the software and the computer will take it over. So you have what we call a single beam spectrum of your background, a single beam spectrum of your sample, but what we all look at is the ratio. So why we do this? Okay, so if you look at this spectrum, what you're seeing is, you can see some noise-like things here. You can see a big thing up here, some noise down there. All this is moisture, this is CO2, and this is, again, moisture. So why we do a background every time or almost very often in FTIR is you want to avoid any moisture or CO2 interference coming from the environment by itself. So that's why we do that. So when we do a measurement or a single beam of the sample by itself, you can see all the peaks, but then what happens is you are ratioing this by this gives you this. So it is very important that you are able to ratio out anything that you are not really interested in. And this can be very powerful also when you have a material. So suppose I have a dot on a piece of paper. If I just want to measure a background of my paper and then measure the dot, I will actually look at the dot or the speckle right on the paper by itself. I can avoid that background by itself completely, can get ratioed out. So that's a very powerful thing you can do. So just quickly, inside of a spectrometer, how does it look? So you have a light source, your interferometer, and the beam just comes into the main sample compartment. And then there is a detector that is going to detect this. So this is a very simple schematic of what we call a benchtop instrument. And for all the lab users tomorrow as well as till Friday, you will have access to a small lab bench as well. So that is where you can run some bulk samples, because remember last time when we picked up the particles, during the extraction class, we have some particles that are large enough that can be picked and moved around with the little forceps. So those are the larger particles we'll try to run on a regular instrument, or a regular small batch, and the smaller particles we can run on the microscope. And why it is important that I am emphasizing this, or why we have this, it's way easier, because for anybody who's really beginning with an FTIR, that they can just start, learn the technique, how this thing works, how an ATR works. You feel very confident before you get into an IR to run it. And there are like large particles that you will always get, which are like 1 millimeter, 5 millimeter. You don't need a microscope for that, right? You just can take it out, put it in directly on an ATR crystal, and you'll see how fast and quick it is. So this is what we will do in lab as well tomorrow. So you have a lot of different ranges that you can cover with an FTIR instrument. But what we will do is we will just focus right on the mid-infrared. And why? Because this is what is going to teach us more about the structure and identity of the materials. So, and then, so, when we get a spectrum, a couple of things you can do, and this is also what we will do this afternoon also, because earlier I think somebody had brought up a question on having polyethylene and polystyrene from two different techniques, but you can get polyethylene and polystyrene on the same sample from the same technique as well. So when you match it up, you may see polyethylene, and then the next one may say polystyrene. So how do you differentiate it out, whether it's polyethylene, polystyrene? Or first thing you have to ask is it a mixture, right? So we have to answer that question. Is your sample pure? Is it giving a really single spectrum analysis, or is it giving a mixture analysis? So we will answer those later this afternoon as well. We will look at a couple of different spectras and see how to do this. So when we talk about like Una, when she started, she mentioned the OH region, yes. And when we talk all our data, we will start to talk OH region, look at the NH region, all these regions, and it can be a little bit overwhelming when you begin this. So what we do is, when we do our trainings as well, like when we go to all the labs and do the trainings as well, we provide these charts, and it's really nice if you put it right behind the instrument, because even on a good day, if somebody is like looking, oh, where should my aromatic show up? Well, you have to think about it, right? So just quickly look at the chart. Oh yeah, if it is a para ortho, that's what I'm looking at. My peaks should show up at 870. Oh, I should see some CHs at 2950 and so forth. So this just broadly categorizes it. So where should carbonyl show up? Where should aromatic show up? Where should aliphatic show up? So it's a quick reminder kind of note kind of a thing. And for the folks who want to do a better spectral interpretation, I would say, we use these spectral interpretation wheels. So what you will see in this is you can just rotate this little wheel to any position, and it will give you all the probable bands that can show up. Again, this is like because you are just learning to do this type of interpretation, it will be a really nice tool to have. I'm sure Jamie has a couple of these in the back, so if you need them for your labs, please pick these up. I think we should have enough for everybody. So if you need, just pick these up. And this would be very, very helpful in the beginning when you are starting to interpret, because your molecules are not going to be just textbook. You will not see a simple polycarbonate ever. You will see polycarbonate with a lot of MI peaks on it, and you really want to think about like, oh, I'm seeing that peak in each bit of my sample at 1640. You need to go in and figure out, oh, that's MI. Oh, that may be something left out from my protein or my digestion or something that's sticking to my sample, right? So so for doing that part, these type of handy tools will be very, very beneficial. Or if you just see, you have a spectrum of polyethylene and you just suddenly see a CO in there, right? You need to know where could that CO come from. Most likely from any kind of fat digestions or anything on the surface of it. So this will be very beneficial for that. So now let's think about all the different things that you can do with spectroscopy. I mean, what we will be doing mostly is identification of polymers. That's the key goal here. But if you want to do quantitative analysis, and there will be later on as the research progresses, as we go further on, may get interested in the quantitative analysis as well. In your field of work, this quantitative analysis can be basically as simple as, oh, how much of a CH load I'm seeing, how much of a CO load I'm seeing. Or it may get down to like, yes, I have only polyethylenes in here, but then let's quantify it down to the milligram levels of how much polyethylene I'm isolating out from this much amount of water. So it can do that as well for you. And we can definitely talk about quantitation as your projects progress, but we will be focusing mainly on identification part in general. So once you have a sample, you want to actually think about, okay, is my sample solids? Is it coatings that I want to look at? Do I want to look at liquids, gases, or mixtures, right? Why it is important is that will help you decide what type of analysis you want to use. Because right now I just spoke of everything in general terms of IR, IR, IR. So, but I think what you also want to learn is IR, when we talk about IR, there's going to be transmission IR, reflectance IR, ATR, and there's a lot of other things that you can do with it. And depending on what type of samples you have, you will use one or the other technique. And in the second part of my discussion with the microplastic samples, what I will show you is analysis of all the different types of materials done in different ways. So that's what I have tried to do with my slides. And then you also have to think about, like, you have a bulk sample. Like, do I have a 1 millimeter sample, or do I have like 0.1, which I don't think I should be pulling out from the filter and putting it in an ATR and analyzing it or anything like that, because the chances that I will lose them. So you have to decide on what you want to do and how many samples and how you want to approach that. So in broad terms, whether you do AIR in a bench, or which is the bulk analysis, or you do a microscopy, these are the four key types of analysis that you will do. Each has its own advantage, own disadvantage. So that's what you really want. So that your take home today should be more like, okay, for my sample set, what will work the best? How will I process my sample so that I can apply one or the other to get the best data in the best possible time? So transmission is actually the most traditional way of analysis, where the light goes through the sample and you're analyzing it. The best thing is you get the best quality data, most sensitive data. The attenuated total reflectance, I'll talk about it a little bit more in detail, because this is the one that you will end up doing a lot. And we will talk about it also later in the afternoon, like why you may do a lot of attenuated total reflectance depending on what your end goal for analysis is. Then you may also do a lot of diffuse and spectral reflectance samples, basically like a lot of quick run analysis where you're just taking a filter, putting it in the microscope is all going to be under the reflectance analysis by itself. The reflectance analysis by itself is going to be the most, I would say, that would give you more artifacts in the spectrum, that would give you more issues, basically like an interpretation of the data and so forth. The first two are great for getting really good quality spectrum. So you may ask, then why people won't do these two, right? It's easier to do those two. There's a little problem. So if you have transmission, it's great. You can run solids, liquid, gases, whatever you want. You can run in transmission, no problem there. You can do the same with microscopy, no problem there. The problem is when you put something in transmission, it has to be really thin. The sample has to be prepared very, very thin. All your material has to be thin. You have a thin film, you have a thin coating, or anything like that, you can easily analyze very well in transmission. And it's really very sensitive, and you can do very nice quantitative work with transmission by itself. And so the real reason that you can do the quantitation so well is that it will follow the Beer-Lambert's law. So remember from the UV-VIS information that Una provided this morning, just like in UV spectroscopy, FTIR will also follow the Beer-Lambert's law. So when it comes to Beer-Lambert's law, basically you are keeping your path length constant and you have an absorbity of the material that depends on the material by itself. And then you can look at concentrations. So this is how you can do really, really good quantitative work. So sometimes when I do these presentations, sometimes I get asked, the first question is, okay, so how low of a concentration can I see? So my answer usually is, it depends. Because, remember, some materials are highly IR active. So they have peaks that are like really big. So the very nice example is silicone or PDMS. It's going to be super duper easy for you to pick up PDMS and silicone, even if it is like in a tiniest speckle, tiniest amount. Because the SiO bonds that you're going to see with all the silicones is very, very strong. It's the strongest bond that you can work with, apart from wood. So it's very easy to pick up. And then the other easy one to pick up would be cellulose, and we will see that as well, like how much cellulose we really have. Because it's really IR active, right? So the second type of analysis that is very, very popular for benches as well as for microscopes is ATR. So what really happens in an ATR? And I promise I'll go through this and we'll take a short break, we'll have questions and then just okay. Because this is where we can stop with the bench and then we can continue on with the microscope. So what we do is we have a crystal. So that can be any kind of crystal. It can be a diamond, it can be a germanium, it can be a zinc selenite, any kind of material crystal that can be used. And most common one for a bench is going to be a diamond crystal. And we all know why diamond is more popular is because it's so rugged, right? You can use any kind of pH, you can use any kind of like rubbing or anything like that, it will be fine. So what happens in an ATR is, so the light hits the crystal at an angle, and this angle is usually the total internal reflection angle and above. So when you hit it at a total internal reflection and above angle, what happens is a small bit of the beam that would, IR beam, will come out right there, and that is called the evanescent beam. That will make the contact with your sample, and you have the pressure on the sample, so it will, that by itself comes back down and reaches the detector. So single bounce ATRs is where the sample makes just one contact and it's just really simple measurements. But what happens is when I say single bounce, it makes just one contact, great for materials that are pure. Earlier also we talked about pure materials. We're just looking for the main component. Great, you can get really good data. But if you are looking for something that is mixed into this material by itself, so you have 95% of one material and maybe like 2% or 3% of something added into that, it's very difficult to detect it with a single bond. So for that, you can use a multi-bounce. What the multi-bounce does is it will make multiple contacts on the sample. So what it gives you is more probability to detect your material on the surface of this particular sample. So like I said, you have a lot of variety of crystals that you can use, and each of them have its own properties. You will see diamond for the benches to be more common, and germanium is very popular for microscopy, and I will come back to that, why germanium is more popular for microscopy. Only remember this number, that is the refractive index of germanium, is one of the best. So germanium is, if you look at the benches, germanium is very popular in where I come from, that is San Jose area, for benches. Why? Because look at the refractive index of it, that is a 4, which is higher than that of silicon. So San Jose being a Silicon Valley, I mean, almost every people who come to our lab, it's like, oh, I have a wafer, I have a coating on it. I have a wafer, I have a coating on it. So they want to analyze mostly wafers, right? So when you analyze wafer that has by itself a pretty high refractive index, you really want a crystal that has even better refractive index. Otherwise, you can see some drifts and forms on your spectrum that you end up having correct. So that's why germanium on the benches is very popular in the Silicon Valley. But it has, because of the same reason, is also very popular for microscopy, and we'll talk about it. So this is a really good time for us to have like a really good question answer session, because some of you I know are very new to FTIR. Some of you have used it maybe for a long time. So all the basic analysis questions, let's talk about it, and is